Aberdeen and Recovery.
Aberdeen and Recovery.
Aberdeen and Recovery.
Aberdeen and Recovery.
We're here for you.
Building that bridge from dependence to independence.
Good afternoon. You're listening to Recovery on Air on Shmu 99.8 FM. I'm Lindsay from Aberdeen and Recovery, and joining me this week is Joan, John, Stevie, and Dermot, also from AiR. Now, for the listeners out there, you'll have heard last week that Dermot and I are taking a week's holiday. So we're actually recording this show a week and a half ahead of time. So you will need to forgive us if we mention something which is current now, which will be completely invalid by the time you hear this. I thought I would maybe ask the guests today if they wish to give their future self a little message. I'll go first. So my message to myself in a week's time is, I hope you're enjoying your holiday and you have done something productive, but also taken some time out to just relax. And if you haven't, do so now by listening to this show. Dermot, would you like to give yourself a message?
Yes. Probably along the same sort of lines as you said, Lindsay. I hope you are enjoying your time off and having lots of fun. And as you know, you will have to give yourself a couple of productive tasks to achieve. But have fun.
Good stuff. Joan, what about you? Putting everyone on the spot today.
Wow, you have put me on the spot there. To myself, just although it's getting darker at nights, and it will start to get darker in the mornings because it'll be a week and a half further down the line, but just don't get too worried about the dark nights and dark mornings. Just enjoy, like I have been enjoying, just getting outside and outdoors as much as I can and getting as much daylight when I can.
Brilliant, Joan. That's a great tip, actually, and we will come on to that in the discussion. Stevie, what are you going to say to your future self in a week's time?
Well, Stevie, but another week closer to Christmas. Just to keep plodding on and be doing what I'm doing, just keeping myself busy and making sure that myself, I'm well within myself.
Good stuff. Great, Stevie. And John, last but not least, what would you like to say to your future self?
To my future self, how's it going?
How's it going?
Drink more water and get more sleep.
It's a good note for yourself.
What is it? Use face cream. No, use sun bash.
What? Sun bash. What's okay. That?
Okay. Now, I think appropriately, we're going to talk today about sort of self-care, general routine, things that can help us stop the wheels coming off completely. I think in Dermot's case, we've already lost him. But the past few weeks, we were covering the self-coaching course. And last week, we just had a general chit-chat about how we all personally sort of what we took from it and things that we use, the tools that we use. And I think that ties quite nicely into what we're going to talk about this week. I think after 7 months of, I don't even know how to describe this past 7 months, but I think just a general chit-chat about self-care and coping mechanisms and, you know, this period has been unusual. I think is an understatement. But also, we're coming into the darker days. Joan, you mentioned at the start there about trying to get as much sunshine as you can. And that is so important. I remember a conversation we had many months ago now, when we were still actually broadcasting live in the studio, about the seasonal affective disorder. And I think we can all be affected by that in some ways. Obviously, it's all to do with chemicals. And again, a couple of weeks ago, we're not scientists, we don't profess to be, but you know, the getting as much daylight as we can, particularly with the darker mornings and darker evenings, is hugely important. I know I certainly don't get enough of it. Walking into town this morning, I ended up getting a bus, and I know I'm going to regret that and feel guilty of it. Because, yeah, we don't get enough sunshine at this time of year where we are. So, general self-care. John, you mentioned as well about drinking more water. That's a thing that I used to be really good at drinking more water, but that's slipped by the wayside as well. I'm very much on the coffee train lately.
Yep, I do. I go through coffee at an alarming rate.
I think it's easier to drink water when it's summer.
When
you get up in the cold, then it's harder to get up and drink a glass of water.
You're right. You're right. When it's cold outside, you want something.
I started making myself water and a cup of tea, and the tea's just started again because it was water in the mornings during the summer.
So, general self-care. Like I say, we've mentioned it so many times in the past as well. This isn't just for people in recovery. This is for everyone. Again, we've all been forced into this unusual way of living for months and months. And there's certain things that we can do to help ourselves get on a bit better. We spoke last week about one of the tools that we use, the STOP tool, and you know, just to sort of bring ourselves back into the present. If our chatter in our heads is getting a bit too much, just to stop and take a breath. Joan, you're far better at explaining this tool than I am. Do you want to explain a little bit about that?
Yeah, I think I mentioned it last week, and it's virtually a kind of stop sign that you can visualize, but the stop is S for stop, T for take a breath, so just focus on your breathing. The O is take an overview or just observe, so that's the O. And the P can then be, once you've kind of taken this helicopter overview, the P stands for then progress. So it's really just giving yourself a little bit of a physical stop of that chatter in your head.
Thanks, Joan. And I've been aware myself that sometimes I go too far down a rabbit hole before I hit the brakes, I guess, and have that stop. And it's something that I could definitely benefit from doing a bit more often. I'm not sure if anybody else wants to add anything about that. Dermot?
Yeah, I think the same the STOP acronym, can be used in allowing ourselves. Currently, we're all living in situations where our liberties are being, we can feel our liberties are being taken away. So it's in some way we can feel as if we're being a little bit attacked. You know, we're being told what to do. You know, because there's lots and lots of rules out there. And we're very lucky in this Western culture that we have liberties We have freedom to do pretty much everything that we may wish to. And currently, we're having to have that taken away. So we can become very defensive. We can become quite defensive when we're feeling under pressure. So it's not surprising that sometimes I'll get an email on my desk and I will read it and my instant reaction is I'm being judged and I will very quickly go on the defensive or on the attack. And what I really need to do is use the stop tool, give myself 2 minutes, 30 seconds to step back from my initial reaction, because my initial reaction will be very, very, very much affected by my emotional well-being. And during these circumstances, I was going to speak about Christmas, but I won't speak about Christmas. We can be making plans and then all of a sudden something happens outside, there's a change in the guidelines and boom, the plans just go, somebody pops your bubble with a balloon. Pops your balloon with a pin. Pops your balloon. So that can be really annoying. So I can feel as if I'm being subjected to. So I use the stop tool to give myself that, just that 30 seconds to step back from the emotion. And then I can respond better. Or I can make a decision, well, you know what? I'm not going to deal with that just now. I'll leave that till later on, to the end of the day, or leave it till tomorrow. I don't need to react to it today. It's a lovely, simple little tool. Comes from the process and the theory or the therapy of mindfulness, which is what I've been falling back on so much over the last 7 months. Mm-hmm. Be present. Deal with what's happening right now. Mm-hmm. Because my fears are always future and my worries come from the past. Yeah. So if I can deal with present, it's really, I'm on a better chance of dealing with stuff. Mm-hmm. John.
Yeah. I'm just thinking as well of an analogy with the stop sign, is that I'm thinking of driving, and when you come to a junction, you don't just charge straight across the junction, like you were saying, you just charge in with your initial kind of thoughts, it's going to be disastrous. Mm-hmm. But if you have to stop at a stop sign and you have to take an overview, you have to look right and look left and look ahead, you have to take time to have an overview and then you make a decision as to what to do. So that kind of analogy for me is really helpful, and it does give you that little bit of space to make the right decision.
I love that. I really love that, Joan. Thank you. So this week we're just chatting about general sort of self-care and what us guys really have been getting up to, and tips and tools that we've been using to try and keep ourselves going through these pretty peculiar times. And Stevie, you've mentioned a few times over the past few weeks, you write stuff down, you find that useful. Do you want to chat a little bit about that?
Yeah, thanks, Angie. I've wrote a journal quite a long time now, before I even realised what I was actually doing it for, if you understand. You know what I mean? I was just writing it. And then I can think of I've done it, and it helps with my thoughts and my feelings. That's what I'll...
I think that's hugely helpful.
Write down and how my day's been. And I think it helps me, because I know... Yeah, I know when I'm not doing it, then everything's getting bottled up inside. I can't, because I went without a pen a couple of weeks back, so I wasn't being able to write anything down. So it was all just staying in my head or in my heart. In my heart or whatever, and it was quite wouldn't say tough time, but it was a hard time because I wasn't getting to express how I was feeling and write my things down. You know what I mean? Because it does, it just like takes a weight off my shoulder. Because I can actually write it down, see it, see for what it is, and it, then it stops running about your head, stops running about my head.
Brilliant. Thanks, Stevie. I think that's almost an extension to that stop tool, isn't it? It's just factoring in different elements at different stages. And, you know, we do tend to go down rabbit holes, as I've mentioned. And, you know, before we realise it, we don't even know that we're in a hole because we've focused on that chatter that's in our heads. We mentioned that last week. And yeah, Stevie, you've, like I say, you've mentioned a few weeks now that you find that massively helpful. Again, that's something I wish I was a bit more, I lack discipline. That's my problem. I do, when I do start scribbling things down, I instantly feel that lift.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, Joan.
Yeah, like Stevie, I always feel better when I keep up the journaling. I do it online, so there's a kind of free online journaling. And so first thing in the morning, it's called bookending, where you jot things down in the morning and then you kind of bookend at the end of the day where you reflect on your day. And I usually try and have like an intention for the day in the morning. And then at night, it's have I achieved that? And they're not big intentions, they're little things, but you always feel so much better if you've not lots and lots of them, just one, mm-hmm. If you've actually achieved that. And I recognize when I haven't been keeping up with the journaling that I don't feel quite as, my well-being isn't quite as good. So, mm-hmm. But it does take a bit of commitment. So a bit like Stevie, I like to write things down, gets them out of my head as well.
Yeah,
that's just reminded me as well, Joan, that the sort of setting out your intention at the start of the day and then, you know, effectively seeing, we spoke about it, gosh, some months ago now, about sort of boosting self-esteem, and we all set ourselves little challenges because that can be one way to improve your self-esteem is by achievement. And if we set ourselves little tasks, and it doesn't have to be anything massive, it's not, you know, right, I'm going to go away and climb Ben Nevis when, you know, I've not walked the length of myself in the last 6 months. That's not going to happen. But, you know, it could be a little thing like, I'm going to do a washing today. I'm going to do my dishes today. I'm going to, you know, a little thing. And if you task it to yourself and you achieve that, that instantly gives you that kind of lift.
You're listening to Recovery on Air at Shmoo 99.8 FM. Recovery, a journey of discovery.
So yeah, we'll continue our chat. Before the break there, we finished up on, you know, boosting self-esteem a little bit and setting ourselves sort of little goals that we can achieve. And Dermot, that brings us on to what you were going to speak about there. You know, after all this months, I think people are going to be feeling a little bit meh.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and quite understandably and quite naturally. We had conversation earlier on about the shorter days, so we're not getting so much sunshine. We're not getting the same vitamin D, which is something very important in raising our energy levels. So this is how it's going to be for the next 2 or 3 months. So motivation can, if it's already at a low peep, going into the shorter days, the grayer days, etc., etc., sad was spoken about, you know, that can have a double impact. So we get ourselves in a situation of a double whammy. Circumstances are really kind of difficult. We can become quite unmotivated. I can't think of another word just now. And that's kind of understandable. But one way, and it's something we speak about lots and we have discussed in the past, is how setting a goal something that really is important to ourselves. It doesn't need to be massive, as we said earlier on, you know, it doesn't need to be climb mountains or lose 10 stone of weight or anything, you know, nothing overly extreme. But actually, I'm looking at a lovely set of shelves that are behind Joan just now. Joan set herself a little goal of, I'm going to get these shelves. I've always liked these shelves, and I think they would be really good in the living room. And I think we'd all agree, these shelves, and you guys don't know it, but it's a lovely set of shelving. And we managed to get them picked up, and we got them over the house. And that's a goal achieved. So in that, we can actually lift our motivation and our energy levels in taking actions to achieve the goal. So we're speaking there about getting a set of shelves and getting them fitted up and et cetera, et cetera. During that period of time, Joan, and I'll let Joan to come in because it's her shelves.
but it's, you know, it's done so much for my well-being. And you'd think, how can a bookshelf with books on it really contribute to your well-being? But I sit, it's in my living room, and I sit and I can go and I can pick a book off the shelf and I can glance through it where I couldn't do that before. And even just the look of them physically, it looks nice, you know. It's aesthetically pleasing, you know, for me. And yeah, it's meant such a lot. So yeah, thank you very much, Dermot, for helping me shift them and, more importantly, construct them, because I couldn't do it on my own. And that's it. We can't do things on our own quite often, and it's looking to other people to help us out when we need.
Yeah, beautiful how that just tied in. You know, Joan set herself a goal. She endeavoured to get it done, and she was making great advances in it. I hope, Joan won't mind me saying, she was getting a little bit frustrated because she couldn't manage to get, you know, how does this work and how does that get together? And she reached out. You know, we have a community, a network. We have a community of people. We have people who, and she gave me a shout, and I went up, and I'm not saying I'm any genius, but we got our heads together and we managed to get the shelves put together and up. And the benefit that Joan has just described, you would never expect that. Yeah. You were just thinking it'd be a good idea. But the benefit out of that task, not only for Joan, but also for me, because I helped Joan to achieve that. And to hear her saying how much she's enjoyed that, there's proof of connection and how connection works.
Definitely. Yeah. Thanks. And yeah, it is. It's, gosh, there's just so much there, you know, that we could speak about for a very long time. But just want to pick up on your point, Joan, how, you know, you said there, how can a set of bookshelves make such a difference? I can completely relate with that. I recently bought myself some plastic boxes, you know, shoe boxes, for want of a better word, because I had a bottom of a cupboard and I've got so many shoes, it's just ridiculous. But I have this, gosh, I could open up a can of worms here talking about this, but I'm absolutely petrified of spiders, okay? I mean, petrified, even saying the word there, I'm coming out in hot flush. And it got to a point where I could only sort of wear the couple of pairs of shoes that were at the top of this pile because I was terrified to rake from anything underneath it. It's insane. I know this sounds insane. It's a proper phobia, which I am trying to work through, and it ain't easy. So I thought, right, I want to be able to wear all my shoes, not all of them at the same time. I still only have 2 feet, but
yes.
Yeah. So I thought, I'll get these shoe boxes. They will all be neat and tidy. They will be directly on the floor, and I am under no illusions whatsoever that I just don't let my head go there. So I thought, if they're all in nice, neat boxes, and I can be able to pull out whatever shoes I want to wear at the time. And that made a massive difference to me. I instantly, overnight, felt like a massive weight had lifted. You know, so it very much is a case of, you know, little things, or what may seem tiny little things, can have a massive impact on your emotional and mental well-being, mm-hmm. For sure. So yes, my phobias and fears and nonsense aside, I don't know, does anyone else have any sort of examples of just little things, little changes or little things that has given them a boost?
I would just like to pick up on what we're speaking about reaching out and connecting. I'm going to pop this one at Stevie because he shared with me how he reached out to a friend of the recovery community and gave him a wee text and just to say how are you doing, etc. And out of that text, he and this other chap managed to meet and go a nice walk round about the riverside down at the River Dee over the weekend, filled a whole day just in pleasant, socially distant company as they walked around that, you know, so reaching and the effort that Stevie made to reach out, the gain for both he and the person he contacted was massive. Yeah, so we might not have shelves to put up in our living room, we might not have a cupboard full of shoes that we need to sort out, but we can get out of self by thinking of another. And that is something that we could all do. That, you know, start it with a text, but I would suggest follow it up with a phone call. Yeah. Mm. Get to hear the voice, how we're doing, and just that, you know, just that small action can have massive benefits.
You're listening to Recovery On Air at Shmu 99.8 FM. Recovery, a journey of discovery.
Just our chat today about sort of general self-care before the break, and what we're talking about now is the importance of connection. And I think it's important to just pick up on, you know, Dermot was explaining there about Stevie, you know, meeting up with his chum and mentioned about socially distancing and the terminologies actually physically distancing. Because I think the impression socially distant tends to imply the isolation factor being, you know, and that's something that we really need to focus on in terms of improving our social connections. And whether that is over a screen or whether that is outside physically distanced, it is just as important. So I just wanted to pick up on that slightly. But yeah, the importance of connection, I think we say it or certainly suggest and imply it every week. You know, one of our biggest assets is identifying who we've got round about us, who can support us in times of difficulty. And I think for everyone, again, across the board, this past few months, it has highlighted that importance that we need to stay connected. And it's also, you know, put that spotlight on people that potentially are isolated. I think coming at the very start of lockdown, way back when, you know, we're now on Guy Fawkes Day. This all started, you know, on the 23rd of March, where we were forced into this isolation. But I remember saying back then, you know, coming from a place of recovery, I think we almost had a head start on the general population. You know, we've had a look at ourselves and we've identified these things within ourselves that we need. So, you know, just like I say, probably the best place, Dermot, you'd mentioned again from previous weeks that we spoke about the self-coaching, there was a thing, or maybe it's not that I'm thinking about, but the cure for addiction is, yeah, connection, is,
yeah,
that it?
Yeah. Uh-huh. We've said, and it's Bruce Alexander that makes a statement in his book, The Globalization of Addiction. He makes a statement that the solution, or the cure, I think he uses, the cure for addiction is not abstinence, it's connection. And it's you know, we don't in any way mean to be flippant. Circumstances recently and currently, people can find themselves, you know, well, okay, it's great you speaking about connecting, but how do I connect? Well, and when you're there, it can seem very hard to find options. But what we're suggesting, and you know, our motive with AiR is, and I'll say it again, and if you're not already sick of it, you will get sick of it, but you know, AiR is here to offer a range of options. We were speaking earlier on, and we have spoken previously about how part of the self-coaching course is learning to get comfortable in environments that we're not comfortable in. So I would suggest that because physically getting together with people who are out with our circle isn't allowed, but we can make little tentative movements into being connected online in small settings. Now, AiR offer a whole timetable of opportunities to do that. And one of the best things of the opportunities is I may go into a drop-in or a check-in on a Tuesday morning, and Stevie will come along and he'll say, oh, I done X at the weekend. And I've never heard of that. And he says, oh, yes, I can do this. And I made a phone call here, and now I'm doing the City and Guilds training course on a Wednesday afternoon. Fills my day. It's really good, really interesting, etc. So that little conversation, and it was only me and Stevie in the check-in, but I have gained an opportunity that I can engage in something else and connect in another. I feel better for that. Stevie feels better because he shared a bit of knowledge with me.
Yeah.
So in that connection, me pushing myself out of my little wee comfort zone and broaching my fears to come onto this setting, use it on my phone, I can connect and broaden my range of opportunities. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks, Dermot. Yeah, and it is. It's, again, we've spoken the past few weeks about, you know, a lot of this stuff and, you know, these sort of buzzwords, you know, comfort zones and these things, you know, they do come up quite a lot, but it is massively important. And I guess, you know, it is about getting out your own head. If you've got that negative self-talk, if you've got that, you know, those feelings that, I don't know, I mean, gosh, many, many, many years ago now, you know, I can only describe what I went through as it was almost like a darkness, and it was a very dark place I ended up in, and it took a lot to get out of that. And I spoke about this, you know, way back when, 7 months ago, that, you know, I'm all too aware of my ability to shut off the world and to isolate myself. Not necessarily my intent at the beginning, but certainly my intent at the end. Shut off the world. I don't want to see anyone. I don't want to talk to anyone. And that is just not a nice place to be. And I don't ever want to go back there. And as much days as it can be difficult at times, you know, it's easy to pull the duvet back over your head some mornings and go, oh, no, not today. But don't do it again tomorrow. You know, that's what I can offer there. Just don't do it again tomorrow. Because that in itself can become a bad habit.
Stevie.
Yeah.
Are you happy to share about how you first got over your discomfort in joining the Zoom settings, and but how that is, how that's changed to how
you... the Zoom, well, when it was the lockdown happened, and then I was doing my writing as usual, my daily writing, but that was, and I was started doing like fitness in my house, and then that stopped because I'm not really into jumping about my house fitness wise. I just am. But when
I remember you first called me. You know, I remember you and I first had some conversations, and you were pretty keen to get going. But then you picked something up off the internet, and it really, it made you fearful of the Zoom setting.
Yeah, because it said something like Zoom meetings was getting hacked, blah blah blah, and it was NASA. All these big companies was getting hacked, but they only got hacked little Stevie and King Arthur, like, you know what I mean. So me and Dermot had a couple trial runs of the Zoom meeting, and there was absolutely nothing to be scared or fearful of. It was just the initial, like, this is new, this is I'm not really good with technology as it is, so it was quite scary. And then once we did, after the first one, I mean, we did a couple, but after the first one, I was fine. It was just getting the meeting ID numbers and the passwords and stuff, but it was good. And then it's helped me, it lifted my mood inside, because I was staying connected with the peers that I'd stopped seeing because of the lockdown. So it was like March till maybe May or something before I connected with the Zoom. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. It took a lot of while, but then once, now I'm never off it.
I was just going to say, Stevie, I just wanted to challenge you a little bit there, because, you know, you're saying there, you know, no one's going to hack little old Stevie in Concord.
Well, they did, though.
Yeah, but also, it's not just little old me. When it's that fear, it's real.
Yeah,
You know, that's, you know, in your world.
It's going to happen to me. Who are these millions? It's happening to me. It's got to happen to me. I was this.
Yeah.
And until we face that fear, it just gets bigger.
Yeah. Yeah. You, it grows and grows and grows in your head. You make it grow in your head, which I think everybody does.
Mm-hmm.
But once you step out and go into something new, and if you get out, I like that.
Uh-huh.
You go back to it. You know what I mean? It's the same with the radio show. Months ago, I'm not doing the radio show. I want to do it. And now I'm on every Tuesday. So it's good. You know what I mean? Just like it.
Thank you, Stevie. Perfect.
Yep. Thanks very much, Stevie. And I think we're practically out of time now. So thanks again to all you guys. Just a little bit of information. Check out our website, www.aberdeenandrecovery.org. There's a whole heap of information on there. Another punt, the Family Recovery College is going to be starting on the 17th of November, and that is run by Scottish families affected by alcohol and drugs. You'll get information about that on our website. Keep up to date on all our social media, Facebook at Aberdeen and Recovery, Twitter and Instagram, Republic_AiR. All our previous shows on our YouTube channel, Aberdeen and Recovery. You can contact us if you want to drop us a line about absolutely anything at all. Drop us a line, chatterbox@aberdeenandrecovery.org. And lastly, if anyone out there is suffering and needs some help, please, we've said it in this show, reach out, ask for that help. Help is there for you. And you can contact Alcohol and Drugs Action, their helpline. It's a free phone number, 0333-344-8355, or you can email them helpline@alcoholanddrugsaction.org.uk.
The flame in our name
is to shine a light onto the pathways of recovery,
which will build a bridge from dependence to independence.